الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه مباركا عليه كما يحب ربنا ويرضى جل جلاله وعم نواله نحمده ونشكره ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ذلك ليعلم أني لم أخنه بالغيب وأن الله لا يهدي كيد الخائنين صدق الله العظيم Respected brothers, elders, young friends and honorable listeners, we continue with the amazing tafsir, commentary and exegesis of Surah Yusuf. And we mentioned in our last session how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused the king of the time to see this vision, which had paralyzed all the courtiers. They could not come to an active, meaningful interpretation of the dream of the king. Hence it called for the divine intervention of the skills of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Thereafter Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam gave them the interpretation of the dream. He gave them an active, meaningful strategy and plan, and he also ended with some glad tidings. Now, when the king, he heard this interpretation, he was really impressed that who is this person? He was intrigued that this person is, who is he? He's languishing in the jail. Hence, he called for Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. And when this person, the envoy of the king, comes to Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, did he hasten in leaving the jail? Not at all. He says, no, remember there were some allegations, there were accusations, hurled at Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Hence, until these are not put to bed, then I will not be leaving the jail. So the king, it became a matter of urgency for him. Hence, he summoned those women who had severed their fingers, their hands at the time. And thereafter, when he asked them regarding قَالَ مَا خَطْبُكُنَّ إِذْ رَاوَدْتُنَّ يُوسُفَ عَنْ نَفْسِهِ, you know, what was the matter when you sought to seduce Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam? He said, حَاشَ لِلَّهِ. He's like saying, Subhanallah, مَا عَلِمْنَا عَلَيْهِ مِنْ سُوءٍ. We do not know of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam to have committed any kind of vice, evil, immorality. So when the general women, they confessed to the innocence of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, then the initial guilty party, that was Zulaykha, the wife of the minister, then she comes out and she says, Al-ana hashas al-haq, that now the truth has come out, is now clear cut. Ana rawadtuhu an nafsihi wa innahu la min as-sadiqin. Truth be told, I seduced Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam and he was from the truthful. So this is where we ended our last session, where each guilty party was coming out and confessing the innocence of Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. So now we reach verse 52 of Surah Yusuf, and this is the concluding verse of Surah Yusuf, of the 12 juz of the Quran, where the envoy of the king has come back to Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Now Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, look at the humility of this prophet, of Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. He asked for clarity. Remember, he didn't leave the jail immediately, he asked for clarity. Now his motive was not to make himself appear noble, although we know that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam was very noble. But he says, I wanted clarity for two reasons. ذَلِكَ لِيَعْلَمَ أَنِّي لَمْ أَخُنْهُ بِالْغَيْبِ وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي كَيْدَ الْخَائِنِينَ. Two reasons. Number one is that ذَلِكَ لِيَعْلَمَ أَنِّي لَمْ أَخُنْهُ بِالْغَيْبِ, that the minister, يعني إطفير وقتفير, the high minister, he should know for certainty, because it was in his house that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam resided. And remember, this was a muhsin for Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. He grew up in the house of the Aziz Misr. He had clothed him, he had fed him. So he had done a lot of ihsan upon Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. And Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, he recognized that. So he says, ذَلِكَ لِيَعْلَمَ أَنِّي لَمْ أَخُنْهُ بِالْغَيْبِ. I asked for clarity. I wanted this matter to be clear cut. Why? So that the minister, he should know for certainty that I did not betray him in his absence. Meaning his heart, the minister's heart, it should be clean. It shouldn't be that he's got these doubts lingering in his mind regarding me. Remember, he has done a lot of ihsan upon me. So he should know for certainty that أَنِّي لَمْ أَخُونْهُ بِالْغَيْبِ in his absence, behind closed doors, behind the parda, I did not betray him. I did not commit fornication with his wife. This is number one. وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي كَيْدَ الْخَائِنِينَ. And number two is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not allow the plot of those who betray, of the betrayers to prosper. It shouldn't be that I leave the prison, I leave the jail, and I'm given an honorable position by the king. And then people start to look at me and they think, hey, you know what? It's fine. We can do evil. We can do vice. We can commit evil and we can commit immorality. And then, you know, maybe we'll be put into prison for some time. But, you know, eventually we'll be granted release from the prison and we can take, a public office. And in doing so, people may get the wrong notion that you can do evil and still take public office. And unfortunately, this is the world that we live in today. So the reason is people must realize if you do evil, then your plot, you know, your evil will come back to you some time or another, maybe down the line, maybe 5 years down the line, maybe 10 years down the line. Here in this case, in Zulaykha's case, she had planned against Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. But 7-8 years down the line, the truth came out. Another reason ulama he also mentioned is that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is trying to say that if I took the throne, if I went onto the throne, if I was given this honorable position by the king, and the king, he starts to give me importance, then, you know, those people who have doubts regarding me, they're going to think that, you know, this is a person, i.e. Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, who made lustful advancements towards the wife of the Aziz, i.e. towards Zulaykha, and yet he has been given this honorable position. Hence, they will think, what's the difference between us and him? What's the difference? And in doing so, people will not abstain from sins because they will say, look, you can still sin and you can take this honorable position. So he's saying that وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي كَيْدُ الْخَائِنِينَ. People should know that this position that I've been given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, i.e. the honor that Allah ta'ala is going to give me, is because of my obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why he wanted to clear his name that, look, I have not committed any kind of evil. So ذَلِكَ لِيَعْلَمَ أَنِّي لَمْ أَخُنْهُ بِالْغَيْبُ وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي كَيْدَ الْخَائِنِينَ. Then we move on to verse 53, and this is the opening verse of the 13th juz of the Qur'an, where he says, وَمَا أُبَرِّئُ نَفْسِي. I do not exonerate myself. I do not absolve myself. I do not make my nafs appear free of sin. Now, in the preceding verse, in the previous verse, someone, you know, may wrongly assume that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam was trumpeting his innocence, he was praising himself, he was purifying his soul, his nafs, and he was praising himself. Rather, no, his motive was to set the record straight. So, you know, trumpeting one's innocence, praising one's innocence, you know, purifying oneself, saying, you know, I'm free of sin. This is something which is not praiseworthy in our deen. This is not something which is praiseworthy for the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. This is not something which is welcomed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, Allah ta'ala says in the Quran, أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ يُزَكُّونَ أَنفُسَهُمْ. Do you not see those people who claim sanctity for themselves, who make themselves appear pure? بَلِ اللَّهُ يُزَكِّي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Rather, Allah Ta'ala purifies whom He wishes. In one place, Allah Ta'ala says, فَلَا تُزَكُّ أَنفُسَكُمْ. Do not, purify yourself. Do not claim yourselves to be pure. Why? Allah Ta'ala knows هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنِ اتَّقَى. Allah Ta'ala is well aware of those who are muttaqi and those who are God-fearing. So here, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is saying that I do not make my nafs appear free from sin. And then he goes on to say, وَإِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءِ. Verily the nafs, verily the human ego incites towards evil. The nafs is such, is kathirul amr. It constantly commands a person, orders a person to do evil. Like they say in Urdu, ke nafs ka kaam hi hai bure kaamo ka hukam karna. This is the job of the nafs. It's constantly pulling away at a person, pulling a person towards evil. Like a magnet, pulling a person towards evil. This is why, you know, in one hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions that your greatest enemy, your biggest enemy is the nafs. In one hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's addressing the companions. And he says, oh my companions, what do you think about a friend? What is your opinion regarding a friend, regarding a companion, whom if you befriend, you be nice to him, you be kind to him, you give him luxury, you give him rahat, sukoon, you give him food, you give him drink, you clothe him, then this friend throws you in all sorts of trouble. Throws you in all sorts of trouble. But on the other hand, if you restrain him, if you keep him hungry, if you limit him, if you keep drink away from him, then this friend of yours will benefit you, is a source of benefit for you. So Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in, they're like, Ya Rasulullah, this is the worst of companions. That suppression is the best treatment and kindness is the worst treatment. So Rasulullah SAW said, by the one in whose hands is my life, this is the very nafs that you possess. This is the very nafs that you possess. That we suppress our nafs. If we give the nafs everything it wants, then it has takabbur, it starts to oppress. You know, you keep feeding your desires, you keep feeding your nafs, you keep filling your stomach with food. You give your nafs what it wants, then it will increase the shahwat, it will increase the carnal desires, which will then lead a person to zina and fornication, which will then lead a person to fire jahannam. Rather, if a person limits his nafs, person trains his nafs, person makes his nafs weak by, you know, maybe fasting, maybe keeping away from food, then, you know, ajizi and humility comes within a person. And the person finds it easy then to obey the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why, you know, when a person commits sins, we are very quick to say that, you know, the devil had a share in it. Shaitan had a share in it. You know, it was shaitan that made me do it. But here ulama write that when shaitan, he refused to bow down to Sayyiduna Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, obviously subsequently because of that he became the devil, he became the shaitan. Kana min al jinn, he was from the jinn. Fafasaqa an amri rabbi. He disobeyed the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So ulama say that what incited shaitan, the devil, to refuse to bow down to Sayyiduna Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. So ulama say that it was the very nafs of the devil. It was the very nafs of the devil. So don't underestimate the nafs. The nafs is so, so evil that the devil became the devil because of this nafs, because of the ego. So here Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is saying, وَمَا أُبَرِّئُ نَفْسِي. That, you know, I don't claim to be innocent. Although we know that Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam was innocent. إِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءِ. We all have a nafs which intrinsically is constantly pulling a person, instigating evil thoughts into the hearts and mind of an individual. And these are the two, you know, the two enemies that we have. We've got the internal enemy, we've got the external enemy. The external enemy, we've got the shaitan. And then we've got the internal enemy, which is more dangerous, and that is our nafs. You know, the shaitan, alladhi yuwaswisu fi suduri nas, who is constantly indoctrinating, you know, these negative messages into the, you know, into our hearts and minds, as shaitan. But like ulama give the example that shaitan, the example of shaitan is like the example of a dog. And the example of the nafs is like an immature child. So, you know, if a dog comes in front of you, you throw a few pebbles at it, throw a few stones at it, it's going to run away. Likewise, you do the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, shaitan will run away. But the nafs is constantly, you know, pecking away at you. It's constantly pulling a person towards sins, just like an immature child. You know, you're in the marketplace, you're in the town center, and your child is still a young child, we have a tantrum. He wants this toy, he wants this and he wants that. And the child will not stop crying until you give it what he wants. And this is the very nafs that we have. And it's because of these two, the nafs and the shaitan, that man, that you and I, we find ourselves surrounded by evil. And, you know, ultimately many people, they succumb to their desires and they succumb to the evil that, you know, that we find in our society. And like someone said in the English language, that every time you succumb to any evil, then you may get that temporary pleasure. You may get that temporary pleasure for that few moments, but remember the vice gets a tighter grip around you. You know, maybe a person is involved in drugs, maybe a person is watching pornography, whatever it may be. Initially a person may get the buzz, he's doing it once a week, but he may get temporary relief, but then the vice gets a tighter grip around you. Then it's going to be twice a week. Then it's going to be, you know, every single day. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us. Now here Mufassirun, when they talk about the nafs, they mention that there are, you can say, three statuses of the nafs, or three stages of the nafs, or three variations of the same nafs. And all three of these are mentioned in the Quran. Number one is nafsul ammara, which is mentioned here in the 13th juz of the Quran. Number two is nafsul lawwama, which is mentioned in Suratul Qiyamah. And number three is mentioned in Surah Al-Fajr, Nafsul Mutma'inna. Now let's go through each of these very, very briefly. Generally, the nafs, when it instigates evil thoughts into the heart and mind of a person, when it's constantly making a person commit sins, then this is nafsul ammara. By default, nafsul ammara. A person doesn't have any ihsas, a person doesn't have any regret or remorse over any evil that he's committing. And this is the nafs of a kafir, this is the nafs of a fasiq. But then, when a person makes tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when a person asks the divine help of Allah ta'ala that, Ya Allah, assist me, Ya Allah, help me, so that I can control my nafs. And he works on improving his nafs. He works on improving his nafs. Then what happens? It goes on to the next stage. And the nafs then starts to reprimand him. The nafs then starts to reproach him. The nafs then starts to admonish him. And it goes to the next stage of nafsul lawwama. And Allah Ta'ala takes a qasam by this nafs in the Quran. وَلَا أُقْسِمُ بِالنَّفْسِ اللَّوَّامَةِ. So if Allah Ta'ala is taking an oath, it shows the profile of this nafs. لَامَ يَلُومُ, which means to admonish, to reproach. That when a person goes towards evil, and this is the nafs of the pious individuals, that when a person, you know, has the thought of evil, then his nafs reproaches him. How dare you? Don't go close to it. Don't go close to it. A person wants to miss his Fajr Salah, a person wants to miss Salah, a person doesn't want to give zakat, his nafs is saying, don't give zakat, you'll become pure, you'll become poor. Don't do such and such a good deed. But then his nafs reproaches him. And when a person works on his nafs, then you can get to the stage of nafsul lawwama. And even if a person commits evil, then he will make tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the second stage. And this is the general state of the pious individuals. And then you have the next stage, which is nafsul mutma'inna. You can say the peaceful soul, the immunized souls. Where when the nafs easily obeys the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and progresses in attaining the nearness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the nafs finds only happiness and contentment in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It settles at that stage. It settles at the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't find anything burdensome. It doesn't find anything burdensome. Then the ibadat and doing any act of obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the nafs finds it very, very easy to do. And he finds contentment, he finds happiness in this. Now this stage, this nafsul mutma'inna, you can say the peaceful soul, this is the generally the perpetual state of the Anbiya alayhim salatu. They are at this stage. Then Anbiya alayhim salatu, all of them, they are at this stage. But the awliya Allah, the pious friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they can also reach this stage. How can they reach this stage? By making mujahada, by making sacrifice, by striving, struggling in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a spiritual mentor, by a Shaykh Kamil. You know, just on that, it reminds me, you know, many people, we think, the need for a spiritual mentor, it's only for the ulama, it's only for those people who have studied in the ulums. You know, if I ask someone the question now, that if you were to fall sick, a physical illness, what will you do? You'll go to a doctor. You'll diagnose that illness, and then you will. The doctor will diagnose that illness, and then he'll give you some kind of medicine. Likewise, in the same way, we also have a spiritual aspect to ourselves as well. We're all spiritually sick. We all have a heart. We all have the nafs. And we all know the state of our nafs. We all know the state of our hearts. We have these spiritual illnesses within us. Yet when it comes to our spiritual illnesses, we don't have that fikr. We don't have that worry that what should we do? How can we spiritually excel? How can we attain the closeness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How can I bring my nafs into control? And for that, we also need a spiritual doctor. And that is, you know, being in the company of a Shaykh Kamil. And this, you know, a person doesn't need to be a hafiz. A person doesn't need to be an alim. A person just needs to be, you know, a mu'min. And if a person has this worry and concern, then they can also, you know, pledge allegiance to a Shaykh. And, you know, and then go through that mujahada. And strive and struggle in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by doing so, they can also reach this stage of nafsul mutma'inna, the peaceful soul. And this is the highest stage, and this is the highest nafs. And like I mentioned, this is all the Anbiya alayhim salatu wasalam. But even then, there is still a difference. There is still a difference between the Anbiya alayhim salatu wasalam and the awliya Allah, who reach this stage of nafsul mutma'inna. What's the difference? Number one, is that the Anbiya alayhim salatu wasalam, their nafsul mutma'inna is still at a higher stage. Number one. Number two, the awliya Allah, they will reach this stage, this nafs, by doing mihnat, by striving and struggling in the path of Allah Ta'ala. And the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam by default are given this state. And number three is that the, you know, the state of the Anbiya, of the awliya, of the pious friends of Allah Ta'ala who have reached this stage can always fluctuate and go up and down. From nafsul mutma'inna, they can also, their nafs can go to nafsul ammara, that it starts instigating evil thoughts again. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make our nafs, nafsul mutma'inna. So, in the opening verse here, I'm going to end in a few minutes. Yusuf alayhi salatu wa salam is saying that we all have a nafs. And the nafs is constantly inciting a person towards evil. Illa ma rahima rabbi, except upon the his soul and the individual upon whom my Lord has mercy. And this is the soul of the Anbiya alayhi salatu wa salam. And here, it's also referring to Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wa salam. But Yusuf alayhi salatu wa salam, he uses a very a general expression, saying that every single nafs, and I'm no different, I'm no different, I could have also succumbed to my desires, I could have also succumbed to this. But, and remember, it was he's trying to say that it's no personal achievement of mine that I abstain from sin. Rather, ma rahima rabbi, it was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who saved me. If it wasn't for the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then I would have also succumbed to my desires. And then, this kind of concludes this discussion here. Now some ulama, and this is the diversity of the Qur'an and amazing nature of the Qur'an, they have said that this, you know, these last two verses which I've been talking about here, was not actually the saying of Yusuf alayhi salatu was salam, rather, it was the maqola and the saying of Zulaykha. And this is the amazing nature of the Qur'an. Obviously Imam Razi and other mufassirun, they have opted for the opinion that this was the saying of Yusuf alayhi salatu was salam. But if we opt for the opinion that it was maybe Zulaykha, so she was talking and she said, Al-ana hashas al-haq. You know, now the truth is clear. Ana rawatuhu, I seduced him. Wa innahu lamina as-sadiqin. He was from the truthful one. And then it's a continuation of her speech. And she says, why did I confess? ذَلِكَ لِيَعْلَمَ أَنِّي لَمْ أَخُنْهُ بِالْغَيْبِ. So that my husband, he should come to realize that I did not betray him in his absence. But then a question arises that she did betray her husband in his absence. So, What the Mufassirun are trying to say is that yes, she made lustful advancement, but she did not commit the actual crime. She did not commit and perpetrate the actual crime of zina. So she says, وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي كَيْدَ الْخَائِنِينَ. And then she says, وَمَا أُبَرِّئُ نَفْسِي. I do not exonerate myself. إِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّا. We all have a nafs that instigates evil thoughts. إِلَّا مَا رَحِمَ رَبِّي. Except the soul upon whom my Lord has mercy, and she's referring to Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Inna Rabbi Ghafurur Rahim. Verily, my Lord is Ghafur, is all forgiving, and my Lord is the all merciful. So now this kind of concludes the discussion where Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is speaking to the envoy, and he's spoken about the nafs. Now, the anxiety of the king knows no bounds. The king is now wants to meet Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. So he sends his envoy again and he says, وَقَالَ الْمَلِكُ أُتُونِي بِهِ. Remember, so we realize that Yusuf alayhi salatu hasn't yet entered the palace of the king. So the king, he now calls for Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam for a second time. And here ulama, they mention an amazing reflection that he's called for Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam twice. So before it was وَقَالَ الْمَلِكُ أُتُونِي بِهِ, the king said, bring him to me. And now he said, وَقَالَ الْمَلِكُ أُتُونِي بِهِ أَسْتَخْلِصْهُ لِنَفْسِي. The king says that bring him to me, I want to single him out for myself. I want to make him my special advisor. I want to make him my right-hand man, basically. So here ulama mentioned an amazing reflection, that the first time he addressed Yusuf alayhi salam and he called for Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, it was very passive, it was a gentle expression. But the second time, you know, it had intensified, no, I need him here. So ulama say that the first time he had just heard about Yusuf alayhi salatu, he had just heard the interpretation that this person, he's given this interpretation, he's been locked up in the jail for some reason. But the second time, the king now knows for certainty that this is a skilled person, this is a competent person, this is a wise person, and more than that, he's innocent and he's languishing in the jail. What are we doing with such skilled, competent and wise individuals in the jail? Rather, he needs to be on my side, he needs to come into my court. And I want to make him my special kind of wazir and my kind of prime minister and my right-hand man. Now Imam Baghawi rahimahullah ta'ala, I'm going to end on this. Imam Baghawi rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions when the king's envoy then comes to the prison to give glad tidings to Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, Yusuf alayhi salatu was salam, he takes a bath, he takes a ghusl, and then Yusuf alayhi salatu was salam, he wears the best clothes, he dons the best clothes, and then he makes dua for all of the inmates there. And it was a, you can say, a very emotional moment. You know, on one side, it was joy for Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu, when he's about to leave the jail after so many years. But on the other hand, for the inmates of the prison, you know, they are parting with a brother, they are parting with a mentor, they are parting with a teacher. You know, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, you can imagine the effect that he had on the inmates. That, you know, the inmates were actually, historical narrations mentioned, they were crying on the separation of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Like we mentioned, the prison guard would actually treat the rest of the prison as well because of the barakah of Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Yusuf alayhi salam, he leaves from there, he makes dua for them. He comes to the door and he makes dua to Allah Ta'ala, حَسْبِي رَبِّي مِن دُنْيَايَ حَسْبِي رَبِّي مِن خَلْقِهِ عَزَّ جَارُهُ وَجَلَّ ثَنَاؤُهُ وَلَا إِلَهَ غَيْرُهُ. That Allah Ta'ala is sufficient for me in all matters. Allah Ta'ala is sufficient for me in all matters. And then the king, he arranges for a, you know, royal entourage to come and receive Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, and with honor, with dignity, with izzat, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is then ushered out of the prison, he's ushered out of the jail, and he enters into the palace of the king of the time, Rayyan ibn al-Walid. And now we'll eventually see the fruition of the dream. Now let's wait and see what conversation takes place behind closed doors, and what happens beyond this in the palace of the king. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you and I all the love for the Qur'an. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the tawfiq to do amal. Wa akhiru da'wana. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu ta'ala ala khair.